Merci beaucoup pour cette présentation, pour cette invitation. So I have to apologize first of all because I'm going to show very bad images with bad quality, and they were taken with a cell phone in the libraries with the books on my knees and things like this. So sorry about the quality of the image. And then I'm going to speak English, but with a terrible French accent. So I do apologize about the accent. It's going to be terrible. And if the accent wasn't clear, let me know, and I could try with another one, the Swiss accent, for instance, or we never know. So and thank you very much for the invitation. I spent a lot of years with some of you reading the books, and I'm happy to see that behind the books they are real people, and it's a great moment. So my purpose today is that I'm going to set forth or to look at in a very professionally way, not provisionally way, or very succinctly, some of the relationships established during early modern times, 16th century, mainly 17th century, between the geography of images and their veneration and the new geographical knowledge, what kind of relation we have between geography and geography of images, or images of geography and geography of images. Taking as a starting point the appearance and circulation within Christendom of a new kind of special books referred to by French historiography mainly or Italian historiography as sacred topographies, a new kind of books that that emerge in 17th century, 16th, 17th century. So the first, those topographies, as we know, are systematic descriptions of sanctuaries, relics, festivals, rituals, and also of images, especially of images of a virgin, within a territory. They appeared at the beginning of the 17th century, and their origins can be traced back to both geographical works from the end of the 16th century and beginning of the 17th century, and to polemical and pilgrimage literature, such as Miracle Bouchon. So two origins, geographical literature and polemical literature about image and pilgrimage. The first topographies are probably this one, the Gallo-Flandria Sacra et Profana from Jean Buzelin, appeared in 1620. This is so the title page and the first map in the book. It's the map of Flandre, and which the book is dealing with this part of the southern Netherlands. And the second book is the Brabantia Mariana, written by Augustino Wickmans here, and it's published in 1632. But similar works rapidly emerge, including the images. First case of a single city, for instance, the Iconologia della Gloriosa Vergine Madre di Dio Maria, Protettrice di Messina, di Placido Samperi, with this title page. So we have the image of Maria, and here the city down, the city of Messina. But we have also the Vienna of Sebastian Kaiser, or Venice of the Venice of Flaminio Corner. Can also be images of a territory or an entire kingdom, the Sicily of Ottavio Gaetani, the Poland of Jan Drus, Portugal, Catalonia, so catalogs of images within a city, within a territory, or the old world with the famous Atlas Marianus mentioned yesterday already. This Atlas Marianus of Wilhelm Gumpenberg, published in 1657-59, and later in both in Latin and in German. This is the German edition, the first book of a German edition, but there's an enlarged edition in 1672. Another work could be included in this group of sacred topographies. Of course, it's the Zodiaco Mariano by the Jesuit Francisco de Florencia, initiated in the 17th century and further elaborated in the mid-18th century by Francisco de Oviedo, presenting 100 of images in the form of a constellation around that of a Virgin of Guadalupe, so a kind of sacred topography, but around one special image. With these works or books, but of course there are many other theoretical and practical markers or loci of this change. So I just took the sacred topographies, but we could do the same analysis with other sources. A unique relationship was established between the new geographical knowledge of the Renaissance and the Classical Age, the expansion of veneration of the saints and the Virgin Mary, the missionary enterprise of the Roman Catholic Church, and at times, the political projects of the Habsburgs. So this is what I'm going to study. There is an intertwining of topography, cartography, cosmography, and hagiography in an original configuration, not merely for the purpose of paying homage to a single sanctuary or a limited group of sanctuaries, of mapping their pilgrimage trails or of organizing certain cults, but also to conceptualize the relationships between territory and holiness. This is a great question, I think, between the natural and the supernatural. We'll see this with Gumpenberg, what is natural and or supernatural. Between the singularity of intercessors and the infinitiveness of their manifestation. One virgin, but so many images. How can we explain this and have a justification or legitimation of pilgrimage then? And to build a science of images, pericia, as Gumpenberg labeled his own enterprise. And in any case, it's the purpose of building a very fiable, attested, and objectified knowledge clearly linked to contemporary transformations in religious erudition and more generally in science, the link between objectivity and cult of images, how it's changing in 17th century. So my first point is, there's parts in French, cosmography, universal monarchy, and Mariology. My French is much better than my English. In their own ways, some of these works reflected the debates going on in the fields of Renaissance cosmography and geography, assisting, extending, and illustrating their inquiry and progress. In this way, they help explore the idea of a correspondence between the celestial and terrestrial spheres and shared the conviction that there exists in the world an intelligible providential order for those who know how to reconcile natural philosophy with the principles of a Christian faith, and thus go a bit further the conceptions of Aristotle. The great discoveries enhance this conviction by showing, for example, that the distribution of waters and land on the globe is not as it was imagined by Aristotle, and above all, by appearing to announce the imminent unveiling of the divine plan of the cosmos, as in the famous map of Juan de la Cosa, here, sorry for my Spanish, which is not existing at all, Juan de la Cosa, which portrays Columbus as a new Saint Christopher bearing the Savior on his shoulders. So completely on the left part, we can see the coast of the Spanish, of the islands, American islands, the coast of Cuba, and at the end, Christopher is having the Christ on the shoulder. In fact, this unveiling of a divine plan or plot for the cosmos was accomplished to some extent by the new instruments, both mathematical and visual, whose history is closely linked to discoveries, and which swiftly prove capable of integrating an unprecedented mass of empirical information into a unique device. For instance, the division of the world into segments or gore, and the clock projection of Waldseemüller, for example, but above all, as Bruno Latour has shown, Bruno Latour and many others, of course, the globes and spheres which sparked intense scientific and artistic activity, especially in European courts, and that could be loaded with religious content and expectation. So to compare with this map, I wanted to show those, which is very famous, the Christophorus in the Historical Museum in Basel, where Christophorus is carrying Jesus Christ on his shoulder, but also the armillary sphere. So he's both Christophorus and Atlas, or Christophorus and Hercules. It's interesting. Or this one also, Christophorus carrying the kid with a celestial sphere. as symbols of this new knowledge, signs, as symbol of the new knowledge, signs of power, objects of admiration, and outstanding technical and artistic achievements, the globes would thus serve the intertwined end of missionary and commercial expansion, political messianism, and universal monarchy, and the reconciliation of faith and reason, as evidenced by several developments in the first half of the 16th century and then in 17th century. One particular example, one special example for me, is the cosmography published in 1524 by Petrus Appianus, the cosmographer of Charles V. A copy today in the public library in Boston contains a spectacular book plates and owner's marks where one can make out the contemporary portrait of the emperor with armillary sphere. So this is the title page of the Cosmographia of Petrus Appianus, and with a portrait of Charles V on the left side. But we could also mention several portraits of the same time, of same period or later, of Charles with a globe here, for instance, where we can see the hand touching the American coast. Charles with a globe or a planisphere, where Spain and especially and also America can be seen. A 16th century engraving of the emperor in armor, a portrait attributed to Parmigiano, another one better known to Rubens, this one. We also have the 1627 representation of a planisphere sheltered under the wings of a two-headed eagle in Kepler's Emperor Rudolph. This one, so the planisphere with a two-headed eagle. Or more interesting, but I took the picture on my knees, so sorry about this with my mobile phone. A 17th century illustration for a book, which is a history of Emperor Charles V here, where the emperor appears as Atlas, carrying the globe on his shoulder and surrounded by animals and allegorical figures symbolizing the four parts of the world, and which are precisely the ones on the frontispieces of many contemporary atlases, so like this one, for instance, l'Atlas Janson. The emperor is thus a new atlas, like here. Emperor is, this is also image dealing with Charles V as a new Atlas or a new Hercules. Here he's wearing the lion skin. Hercules, whose hands cups the ocean and spans the sky, has suggested by the reference to Isaiah chapter 40 here, down there. He's the one who reigns over the world because he knows it surely as Hercules did, but also as Atlas, whom a long tradition dating back to Pausanias portrayed as a king and astrologer, not only le titan, king and astrologer, unifying in his persona the different ways of discovering the secrets of the universe. And this is also the Rudolphine table with all the different way of knowing, all the different kinds of knowledge on the cosmos. The synthesis was powerful enough to survive the end of the Renaissance cosmography. Such visual strategies are found throughout the 17th century, linked with the Habsburg, and also later on with Louis XIV, the King of France. The religious wars of the 16th century and the introduction of the legal principle cuius regio, eius religio, such prince, such religion, theoretically bringing a provisional, peaceful solution to the wars, nevertheless, led princes and their advisors to increasingly make cosmography and geographical language the tool of an accelerated confessionalization of the landscapes and of the landscape and its representations, beginning with the sacred topographies, which are tools of confessionalization, the sacred topographies, which emerge within the particular context of the 30 Years' War. Since it was necessary to accumulate the greatest possible symbolic and religious capital in the Catholic territories in conflict in order to demonstrate the lasting favor of God and of saints, to visibilize or visibilize, yes, the confessional border or frontier which was forming, and to assign to each his place, topographies were mustered in the service of confessional construction, a species of devout poliorcetics in the topographies. They thus combine the siege mentality of the frontier, sort of mentalité obsidional siège, mentality of the frontier, and the exaltation of the Catholic Reconquista of the 17th century, very much in the likeness of the different editions of the Atlas Marianus of Gumpenberg, or of the works of Florentiano Oviedo, in which miraculous virgins become veritable fortresses against heresy and idolatry, outposts of the faith in areas that still refuse to accept the word of God. In the title page of Gumpenberg, we'll see this later, but in the title page of Gumpenberg, the sun of the true faith, already shining in Southern Europe, is slowly rising upon the lands of the Northern European countries that are still Protestant countries. So the sun is rising and will soon or later come in the Northern Europe. But I'll go back to this, sorry. We could also mention the construction of, this is the title page of a later edition of the Atlas Marianus of Gumpenberg, and I'm interested in the fact that we can see both Atlas and Hercules down Atlas, and the Virgin helping both of them to maintain the equilibrium of the cosmos. They need help. And this is exactly a contemporary Atlas of the Netherlands, and we have also Hercules and Atlas collaborating. What is new in Gumpenberg is the use of Mary helping the two other characters. And we could also mention in this siege mentality the construction of a pilgrimage church of Scherpenheuvel during the first years of the 17th century, with by Wenceslas Koberger in the shape both of a star and a fortress. The pilgrimage church is a fortress, is a star and a fortress. Yeah. It is from this perspective that one must interpret the substitution of Mary for the figure of Atlas in the frontispieces of Gumpenberg, or her enlistment, like here, as the Queen of Heaven next to Hercules, both visual choices serving an ambitious aim, namely to place the exaltation of knowledge at the service of the Christianization of heavens, an illustration of the Catholic reconquest under the protection of Mary, and the sacralization of the territories in harmony with other contemporary strategies ranging from promotion of state saints, les saints d'état, states, sanctioned saints, or the consecration to the consecration of kingdoms through Mary, Bavaria 1615, France 1638, Austria 1645, and including the multiplication of Marian columns, Munich, Prague. So ways of sacralizing territories and having a consecration of consecration of kingdoms and towns. The increased importance of geographical and topographical devices in those compilations of images or miraculous relics that are no longer exclusively inventories or production of loci communes on the Virgin, and in Gumpenberg the adoption of the Atlas form speaks of these confessional issues, for their specific function is to demonstrate the accumulation of symbolic capital contributing to the sacredness of a specific territory, but also to showcase the universal claims of a post-Trento Catholicism and the Habsburg monarchies. On the one hand, some cartographic enterprises, such as that of a Jesuit Scherer at the end of the 17th century, managed to associate with each territory either a generic indicator of a devotion to Mary or a precise or principal sanctuary of Mary for each territory. So this is the Atlas Marianus of Scherer, So 50 years later than Gumpenberg, and it looks like this. So for each territory, this is a late copy with colored from 19th century, I suppose. But for each territory, there's a pilgrimage. So we have the personification of Gallia, and with coats of arms, and Notre Dame de Laon, Laudunensis, Notre Dame de Laon, the Virgin of Laon in north part of France, as principal sanctuary for the kingdom. Here it's Poland, and of course the principal sanctuary is Czestochowa. So this is the choice of the Jesuit Scherer at the end of the 17th century. Each territory has a principal sanctuary, charged with expressing the piety of the inhabitants and the special protection they enjoyed. On the other end, certain cosmographic devices announce the universal reign of Mary, since precisely the form of Atlas, at once open and systematic, always allows for the addition of new map, new sanctuaries, new images. It's an open form. So Atlas, you can put more examples, more images. And as with Gumpenberg himself, who increased the number of shrines mentioned in his book from 100 to 1,200 between 1657-59 to 1672. Before the 19th century and 20th century, publishers and imitators of Gumpenberg managed to amass even larger collections. For example, the one called Atlante Mariano, which is published in Italy in mid-19th century with you, and also the collection of books published just after Second World War with the title Maria. And it's a book for each country, and it's a huge amount of collections of examples of a cult of. So coming to my second, this is another, this is the title page of Gumpenberg, a German edition published in, it's the global edition and enlarged edition just after the translation, just after the Latin complete edition of 72. It's in 73, published in Munich with this kind of image dealing with. So I'm coming to my second point, Christian heavens despite everything, despite science. The end of the specific ambitions of cosmographic thought and the profound changes that undermine the geocentric system between the end of the 16th century and the beginning of the 17th century did not discourage authors of recollections and catalogues of images or relics from taking part in the debates about the universe and the laws that govern it, regardless of whether they were held or not to be accessible to men and to reason. On the contrary, everything indicates that these works, however disparate they may have been, however different they may have been, were extensions of the efforts, especially by the Jesuit mathematicians and astronomers, to use the new tools provided by this knowledge for the purposes of religious demonstration and the preservation of a Christian dogma. These tools could thus be used in controversies about the Immaculate Conception, which raised doubting questions about the history and organization of the universe, huge questions, and or used in the widespread attempts to reconcile dogma and the theories of Aristotle and Ptolemy, in the context of the decrees of Paul V condemning Copernican heliocentrism. One of the most significant examples of his delicate struggle is Christoph Scheiner, a Jesuit active at Ingolstadt and a pioneer in the discovery of the solar spots, in the sun, who published his observation in the late 1620s in his work Rosa Ursina in response to Galileo. So sorry about the quality of the image. In response to Galileo. The frontispiece makes it clear he wished to reconcile the new techniques of observation based on the use of a telescope to a conception of a cosmos faithful to geocentrism. To geocentrism and recognition of the central place of the divine persons and the saints in the order of the universe. around the sun and the zodiac signs are assembled the different forms of knowledge on the cosmos, and the authorities legitimizing them. Divine authority on the left, up on the left, and mathematical reason on the right, the profane authority of science and direct observation with the aid of a telescope in the lower part. Thus, a system of knowledge that is at once separation and hierarchy between the two kinds of knowledge, distinction and blending. The demonstration itself confirms this principle. The last part of the text defends geocentrism with help of the Bible and the fathers of the church. The astronomers and mathematicians Jean-Baptiste César, Paul Gouldin, Julius Schiller, also from Augsburg and also a student at Ingolstadt, were among those with whom Scheiner was in contact. In the 1620s, Schiller, Augustine Monk himself, organized with the help of Johann Bayer, the author of the constellation Atlas Uranometria, a project for a collection of celestial maps entitled Coelum Stellatum Christianum. This one, Coelum Stellatum, so of Schiller, in which the constellations named for the signs of the zodiac and the ancient gods were replaced by Christian constellations, like this one. So this is Libra and it's Philip, or this is this one, the constellation. The constellations of the zodiac were renamed with the names of the apostles, the northern heavens identified with the New Testament, and the southern heavens with the Old Testament. Thus, St. Taurus was replaced by Abraham and Isaac, Taurus by St. Andrew, Libra by Philip, Cassiopeia by Mary Magdalene, and so on. In order to assist him in this endeavor, which combined a vaulting scientific ambition with a very clear religious project, Schiller sought the advice of very famous members of the Society of Jesus, such as the astronomers Johann Baptist César and Paul Gouldin, already mentioned, and the philologist and historian Matthäus Rader. He also sought help from the cosmographer Wilhelm Schickard, the painter of historical scenes Johann Matthias Kager, and the engraver Lucas Killian, who created the images of a new constellation. This is Lucas Killian. The latter was, in fact, the brother-in-law of Wolfgang Killian, who engraved the frontispiece of the first editions of the Atlas Marianus of Gumpenberg. It matters little that Schiller's system should have failed to dethrone the old designations of the constellation, which had the weight of history in their favor. The project of Christianizing the heavens did not disappear with him, as evidenced by two later experiments which were strongly inspired by him. A few years later, Wilhelm Schickard himself, so this one with tools and is astronomer and professor of Hebrew, created a celestial map that added Christian captions, Christian names, suggesting biblical equivalents to the traditional figures. Perseus is compared to David, Draco to the dragon of the Revelation, and so on. Sorry for the quality of images, but there's only one copy of the book. It was difficult. And in 1660, in his Harmonia Macrocosmica, the Protestant Andreas Cellarius published the spectacular maps of an entirely Christianized sky. This one, so. Significantly, these maps adopt the viewpoint of God so that the sky is viewed from heaven, not from earth. This map unveils the spectacle of creation in accordance to Psalm 19, the heavens declare the glory of God. And so this is one of them. There can be no ignoring that these fully Christianized heavens readopt the canons of the Tridentine iconography. It is striking how they give the saints their most classical and recognizable attributes, populate the heavens with intercessors sharing in the glory of God and offering men their protection, endowing these protectors of humanity and divine characters with the features and attributes of the ones found on the vaults of churches designed and decorated by the Jesuit fathers. So the iconographical similarities are very strong between those heavens and heavens in the church. The claim a consistent iconography of the Christian heavens, thus developed from the scholarly works to temples, from place of debate to places of prayer, thus rendering sight and vision both cognitive and spiritual, its inner eyes, outer eyes, view from inside and outside. The claim to universality of the images of post-Trento Christianity is thus based on the Catholicization of the images of the universe, with which it has evident relations. The saints, the Virgin Mary, the divine persons made visible and devoted to prayer for the benefit of all, give order to the world, guarantee its equilibrium, and extend the protections everywhere over those who call on them, without which the heavens could come tumbling down on the earth, according to Gutenberg. So I'm going to have my last point on the devotional pericia of Gutenberg. The sacred topographies, the Mariological atlases, the Christianized maps of the heavens, or the territories developed in all that, an original theology of images, but without there are books with theology of images or with special discourses on ontology of images. They are not purely recollection or collections of examples and devised to help prayer and predication. They have also a theological content on what is images. But without taking up the tone and arguments of the true treatise of De Imaginibus of the 16th and 17th century. These achievements, which gave visible form to the to theoretical and empirical knowledge about space, speak to a number of key debates concerning the knowledge about space, concerning the cult of images, on which the denominations or confessions were divided, and from time to time Catholic themselves, as shown yesterday, about veneration, for instance, what kind of veneration should be given to images. The first pages of Zodiaco Mariano, or the Atlas Marianus of Gutenberg, are perfect examples of the debates, theoretical debates, behind those atlases. They explicitly focus on the diversity of the images you mentioned yesterday, the diversity of images of Mary, the variety of names they receive, and the miraculous deeds they perform, and their geographical dispersion in Mesoamerica and the rest of the world. In the words of Florencian Oviedo, the images of the Virgin, this is the text, are illustrated, sorry for a translation, it's not mine because my Spanish is what it is, so nothing, are illustrated with the various titles of our mysteries or our favors. Some are of our Immaculate Conceptions and others of our Assumption, and still others of your favors, some of your Immaculate Conceptions, others of your Assumption, and still others of your deep sorrows. Some go by the name of Loreto, others Guadalupe, and yet others Remedios. Gutenberg chooses to include these distinctions in the vast index system of all possible images of Mary, the core and most striking singularity of his works. Images of the Virgin Mary are classified according to their material, their iconography, their location, their place of creation, creators, in an impressive branch system which take as much from the Ramist logic as from the typologies of the Loci Communes. And for instance here, this is part of the index of Gutenberg, and 300 pages of index like that. So different images are ranked or categorized by inventio, by cultus, by materia, forma, and this is only part of it. And then if you go in details, it's much more precise. We have inventio above the ground, underground, on the ground, by every kind of possibility, so with numbers, and the numbers are referring to images described inside the atlas. So this is building a new tool for predication. I want to have a predication on image found on the ground by a shaper. It's very easy. I have example immediately for me, but it also it's also creating new kind of relations between images, put in contact images that are not in contact, far away, or from different material, different loci, or different places, different times. In either case, however, the issue is obviously the same, namely the relationship between the unity of a prototype, Mary, and the diversity of material representations. This is what has core. How to explain the confusing diversity of the images of the Virgin Mary, the different names, appearances, and features, if they all represent the same person? And if some of these representations of Mary were created by St. Luke from the life, how can there be so many different versions of it? Are these many different people or many different images of the same person, which is the acknowledged test of authenticity of those images? But in the latter case, which is only defensible in theory, how to justify, as you said yesterday, pilgrimages to distant lands, while nearby there are other images within sight or praying distance that would bestow the same honor on the prototype? As we know, that was one of the Calvin's severest criticism of cult of images. So you believe in images and not in what they represent because you go so far away. Gumpenberg explains this analogy with magnetic stones, magnets, thus taking up Kircher's research on magnetism. He took part to the research of Kircher for Germany. But also certain speculations taken from Marian sodalities. So this is Kircher's title page on magnets, and you see you have chains linked together without, I tell it in French, les anneaux sont pas inclus, mais se touchent et les chaînes sont très solides. And copies, images of famous images, images of relay, sanctuary relay, for example, numerous pilgrimages to Notre Dame de Lorette or Notre Dame de Passau, retain some of the power that animates the original images. This is like the magnet stones. They give the power to another one, to another one, and make strong chains that the eye cannot see. They are like relics, but work at distance without the need to touch or be in physical contact with one another. It is their holiness, their symbolic power, which connects and unites them. I tell it in French, Gumpenberg fait une page sur le magnétisme et compare la puissance symbolique des images qui sont en contact les unes avec les autres à ce qu'il a observé avec le magnétisme et explique ainsi que prier une image, c'est bénéficier de la protection de toutes les images. Voilà, qu'il y a un système de force qui joue. This assertion led Gumpenberg and the Jesuits who succeeded him in Freiburg, is living in Freiburg, Switzerland, so a Catholic canton, to think about the construction of a local sanctuaries functioning as worldwide devotional machines or tools where the faithful could pray before all the images of the world and benefit from their help without having to travel far and wide. Some of these sanctuaries were made of simple paper. This is the sacred topography. It's a temple made of paper. It's a paper museum. Sacred topographies themselves. Temples to read, but not to visit. Paper museums of saints and Mary, where holy Catholic treasures were displayed and venerated. But other temples were real. Others were real. The Jesuit fathers did not only export images and patterns of images to the New World, they also imported from it new exempla and mirabilia and new images. A few kilometers from Fribourg, in the second half of the 17th century, the Jesuits built the Posa Chapel. It's a very small chapel. It would be half of a room here, very small, whose rich decoration included the saints of the society, but also, in form of small paintings, the engraving of the first edition of the Gumpenberg Atlas Marianus. These were copied in the format of small paintings, A4 size and in color. So, for instance, this is one, also the Marian sodalities, use of Arcanis Nodis with magnet stones and so on. In Marian sodalities or I have many other examples, but this one maybe is enough. And this is one of the picture. It's Nuestra Señora de la Ligua in Chile, in Gumpenberg. So it's an image here. Read about this, and someone sent copies of image from the South American place. This image to him, and he had it engraved in the first book, the first 25 pilgrimage mentioned in the Atlas Mayanus here, and this is the picture you can see now in Freiburg, in the private collection of a bishop, but they were initially in the Posarch Chapel. This is it. And so we have copies of every image's weapon, but parts of those pictures were lost. So hence, just a few kilometers from Fribourg, the faithful, the Christian, could meditate and pray before the Virgin of Montserrat, the Virgin of Candelaria of the Canary Island, or those of Arauco or Ligua in the Kingdom of Chile, without the risk of traveling far and wide or crossing the ocean. In fact, they didn't even have to cross the borders of this Catholic enclave surrounded by Protestant territories. They could pray all the Virgin of the world at home. The sacred topographies accompanied and certified the advent of a new geography of images, both global and local, inasmuch as the systematic growth in their number hastened the decline of long pilgrimages and the growth of short ones. In 17th century, the long distance pilgrimage are less and less important, and people are traveling in the neighborhood sanctuary. In 1674, for example, a book published in Venice proposed, among the many devotional exercises it described, spiritual pilgrimages either to the holy places of Jerusalem or visit to the most famous churches or sanctuaries of the Virgin Mary. Today, quotation, without leaving your cell or cloister, you can embark upon a spiritual pilgrimage with all the other devotees of the Virgin Mary. You can, for example, travel devotionally to Loreto to venerate and worship the Santa Casa without leaving your room. Many sacred topographies also pursued the aim of unifying devotions, transcending the local specificities and the infinite variety of modes of worship. In this connection, it's worth highlighting, and this is really my last point, the importance they place on both the rosary and the signs of the zodiac, as evidenced by the abundant devotional literature which in part forms the backdrop for the achievements of Julius Schiller and Andreas Hilarius. This includes the Zodiac Mystique of Charles Moreau, this one, 1624, the Zodiac Mystique, the Zodiaco Rosario Mariano of Peter Paul Rosenberger, here, sorry for the image, with prayers of the Virgin Mary assigned to each sign of the Zodiac, or the Zodiacus Marianus by Michael Ginkiewicz, here, a Jesuit very active in the Lithuanian border here, which I find interesting because it's partly inspired by Rosenberger, or the Zodiaco di Maria, ovvero le 12 province del Regno di Napoli, illustrate da questo sole per mezzo delle sue immagini from Serafino Montorio, where Montorio have those images with each sign of the zodiac, some prayers and some reflections on Virgin Mary. Of course, the exegetical traditions mentioned in this text are very considerably, insisting here on the 15 mysteries of the Virgin Mary, there on the 12 virtues. Louis Abeli, Bishop of Rodez and author of a short treatise on devotion published in 1653, refers, for example, to the 12-starred crown described by St. John in relation with the Virgin of the Apocalypse, and he proposes that for the devout, this can, I quote, serve as a mystical zodiac to propose these 12 virtues of the Most Holy Virgin to practice throughout the year. but in all cases, the aim was to encourage devotion to the Virgin Mary through the rosary in an extension of the decisions of Pope Pius V and at the time of Lepanto, and moreover of Gregory the 13th. So just a word of conclusion, and in French, j'ai voulu montrer le lien entre géographie des images et images de la géographie, montrer qu'il y a une configuration particulière de la cosmographie de la Renaissance et de son projet d'un savoir complètement unifié, qui met en relation les sphères terrestres, sphères célestes, et aussi microcosme et macrocosme, que l'écroulement du projet cosmographique de la Renaissance ne met pas fin au projet d'utilisation des nouveaux instruments du savoir à des fins de construction, soit d'une justification d'un ordre céleste voulu par Dieu contre Galilée et contre Copernic, durablement, jusque dans les années 1650, soit dans des efforts très précis et très méthodiques de christianisation des paysages et d'imposition d'une nouvelle géographie théorique et pratique des images à travers les pèlerinages. Voilà. Merci.